This video deals with Arknights Independent Contractors, an Arknights Dungeons & Dragons campaign made up of Polarisu, Sessif, Seven Para, Dio's Opinions, Skorak and me, which you can find over there on the Harm Assist channel. Even if you have no idea what Dungeons & Dragons is or how it works, what you will find over there is a group of boys being boys and waifus with a story set in the world of Arknights, so come and join us every Sunday, 2 hours after the Arknights Daily Reset. The second story arc has just started, which means that there is no better point in time to get into it than now. For that, I will make a couple of videos, which are going to summarize everything that happened until then. Gamers, grab a snack and a drink, and enjoy the recap. In a rundown warehouse in the rather bad parts of a city called Corinia, a group of absolute misfits gets proclaimed as the new CEOs of a company called Eden Logistics. They are a Draco called Semblance, a Feline called Katze, a Sarkas called Halbert, a Sancta called Kelkydra, and an Arcosauria called Rock. The one appointing them is a Pythia with a mechanical mask. His name is Mem. Although technically their employee from now on, he clearly places himself over them, he speaks in a very commanding manner. In fact, he straight up tells Kelkydra that originally he wasn't even supposed to be appointed. The Sancta doesn't really care about that, and instead asks Mem whether he can get some wine. The snake uses an intercom to order his sister into the basement so that she will look for some wine there. Halbert has never dealt with a situation that complicated in his life before, so he decides to ask Mem up front whether he was the man who asked them all to get here, which he denies. That was the former CEO, a man called Aleph. He is not among us anymore. Katze gets very sad upon hearing this. Apparently, he was a father figure to her. Halbert also asks whether he knows something about Asia, the sloth cyborg who they found, fought, and then recruited in a warehouse which belonged to a gang. The snake says that he doesn't understand why he should know something about a random gang member, implying that this was a stupid question. Rock suggests to fire Mem, but Semblance says that he will be helpful to her and that's why she's going to stay. Since Halbert has a crush on Semblance, he will stay as well. And since Rock thinks that Halbert is Gaviel the Great Chief, he will also stay. Katze was supposed to be Aleph's successor from the get-go, and Kelkydra was a courier working for the company, so it's settled, the new CEOs will stay. Meanwhile, Mem's sister has arrived with the wine. Her name is Lamette, she's also a Pythia but without any mechanical parts. She timidly hands Kelkydra the fluids he wished for. Mem starts lecturing his new bosses about what he needs them to do. The Eden Logistics building is completely run down and around 5000 LMD are needed to make it fully functional. It seems like there right now is exactly one job in Corinia which would pay that much. He shows it to them using a hologram coming out of his arm. The destruction of the Trifactor gang, the biggest crime syndicate in this city, also the gang they had fought earlier. In order to complete the mission, their main task would be to eliminate the gang's leader, a man called Sun. Kelkydra frowns when he hears that name, he seems to know him. Expecting a handshake, Mem extends his hand towards Semblance. It's partially mechanical and partially a black hologram, it seems to be glitching out of reality. Since Semblance isn't really reacting, Halbert gets in between them, saying that they maybe shouldn't touch something like that. Katze agrees, saying that maybe it's time for everyone to rest. She asks Mem about where they can do that here. He seems very disappointed by the fact that no one accepted his handshake, but he answers there is one sleeping room with 5 bunk beds which they are all supposed to share. Katze says that she would prefer a room for 2. Mem quickly says that he is not interested, but he agrees with them getting some rest. He needs some thinking time alone after talking with all of them. The new CEOs and Asia go to the sleeping room and their first day in Corinia ends. The next day starts with a loud siren and blinking red lights. Semblance gets up and while everyone rushes down to see what happened, she notices that something is wrong with Asia. She is moving extremely slowly. She points at the vials she has with her and then at her neck. The Draco takes one of the vials and injects it to her. Immediately she is able to move normally again. Everyone is at the ground floor. Mem uses his hand to show the Eden building. 3 enemy teams are attacking the rooftop, the first basement and the reception. It is the Trifactor gang, equipped with guns and mechanical battering rams. he splits them up into three teams so that they can deal with this threat. The reception gets attacked by four grunts. Asia and Kilkhydra will deal with them. She catches their bullets out of the air, throws them back at them, and slices one guy into two pieces. He punches one guy to death, and the other two just run away. They then decide to split. The Pilosa will go to the basement, the Sancta to the roof. The basement attack consists of two grunts and one man leading them, a huge Petram man wielding mechanical punching gloves, whose name is Ox. Rock apologizes to them, hoping that they will leave because of that. Ox is willing to accept the apology, only if Halbert comes with them. Rock would never give the Great Chief to someone, and so negotiations are over. Halbert kills one grunt, causing Ox to rage and to punch him unconscious. Rock continues fighting him for quite some time, until Asia gets down. The big turtle seems to recognize her, throws a smoke grenade on the floor, and runs away as fast as he can. While Rock stabilizes Halbert, he tries to explain to Asia that Halbert only lost because the gang was cheating. She just turns and rushes to the roof. Shoulder by shoulder, the two warriors also make their way up. The roof got attacked by a Forte woman called Hecate and two grunts. She seems to be looking for a place where she can break through the actual roof. The moment Katze and Semblance get up, she immediately notices them. She explains that they are not here to kill, they just want to know who attacked their warehouse and why. Once she sees that the two CEOs were among the ones to do that, she engages them into a fight. The two are way weaker, Semblance gets taken down rather quickly. Katze manages to slice one grunt's throat after showing him her chest. In the end though, she also gets defeated by a very angry Hecate. As she gets ready to end Katze's life and to take Semblance with her, Kilkhydra shows up on the roof. It took him pretty long to get up there, because he got a pineapple pizza on the way up. The moment she sees him, her eyes widen. She recognizes him and gets very angry. The one living grunt almost wets himself and grabs her by the shoulder, telling her that they should leave. The Forte explodes, telling him that she will never forgive what he did to Sun. Before she actually can do something though, Ox climbs up the roof and calmly asks her to retreat, which they all do. After some time, everyone else arrives at the roof. Katze and Kilkhydra get stabilized by Rock and Asia. They want to know how Kilkhydra managed to win the fight on the roof, and the man just says, "Guess they're afraid of pineapple pizza, I guess." Everyone gets down to the reception. Mem and Lamed are already working on the damage caused. That means Mem is giving the orders, Lamed is carrying the actual huge parts of the metal door the gang destroyed with its battering ram. Snake Man asks about how the battle went. Some consider it a loss, some a win, but Mem wants to know exactly why the attackers of the roof retreated despite clearly winning. "They were afraid of pineapple pizza, it's just that simple," Kilkhydra explains. Mem leans in closely to him and reminds him that he was an employee once. He should remember his obligations. Then he proclaims to everyone, "If they intend to wage a war on us, we have the means to fight back." He tasks the CEOs to find the location of the gang's HQ. They discuss how to do that. Asia suggests that they should all stick together, while she would go ahead and scout on her own as well. Mem agrees and hands out two earpieces to Halbert and Asia. As the CEOs leave through the main entrance, Lamed hands them three envelopes. Semblance asks her what those are, and Lamed gets very scared and deeply bows before her. Mem tells them to not worry about that. On the outside, they decide to open the envelopes. The first one is a map of the city with an arrow pointing at a point close to a park. The second one is just a bunch of letters and numbers, complete gibberish, but Katze sees what it actually is, an encoded message. A letter addressed to her. It's from Aleph, the old Eden CEO. He addresses her as his daughter. He's very proud of her, he knows that she will finish what he started. The lab is in the second basement. Furthermore, he tells her that she should treat Mem and Lamed as her siblings, but never as her equals. A few tears run down Katze's cheeks. She tells the group that they have to open the lab at some point, since he was researching on a cure for oripathy. The third one is a letter by Mem. He says that he's proud that they were smart enough to open the envelopes. He then gives them a bunch of locations where they might find information. They decide to check on the park first though. They search through it for a couple of minutes, and then they suddenly hear someone yell. All of them quickly run into the direction from where the yell was coming. Apart from Kilkhydra, he runs in the wrong direction. They get out of the park and see a feline girl who is getting beaten up by two grunts. Four others are standing close to the scene, and the CEOs recognize one of them. Jeff, the Manticore man who they fought in front of the first warehouse. Having survived that attack has given him so much respect within the gang that he now leads this unit. Rock wants to negotiate. He announces his presence to the Manticore man, who gets horribly annoyed by his sight. Rock wants to know what's happening. He explains that they had a deal, but she didn't have their money. Rock doesn't like that. He tells them to stop. Jeff nearly gets a heart attack from how angry that makes him, but he reminds himself that he is not allowed to kill and calms down a bit. The Arcosauria proceeds to explain what's morally wrong with beating up someone. The Manticore calmly asks him to leave. Rock doesn't leave. Instead, he makes the following offer. If it makes you feel better, beat me up instead. Jeff actually likes the idea of that, and as they get ready to beat the crocodile up, Halbert, Semblance and Katze attack. While everyone fights the grunts, Rock does not draw his weapons. He walks up to Jeff, puts a hand on his shoulder, and continues walking towards the girl that's getting held by two mafiosos. Jeff again almost gets a heart attack and gives the order to fire. On the roof of a nearby building, one sniper rifle and two sniper turrets start shooting. Shortly after that, Halbert strikes down Jeff. While he walks on to support Semblance, Katze rushes to his body. She might or might not have taken a liking to his long tail. She wants to perform CPR on him, but something happens. Weird injectors on his wrist inject something into him, and he slowly wakes up to Katze's sight. He is very confused. She tells him that she knows that he is a good person and that he should change sides or at least stop fighting so that they can go and drink a coffee together. The fact that Halbert kills one of his men while she is saying that doesn't help with convincing him, but eventually she manages to get through to him. He orders his men, who are still alive, to flee. That doesn't apply to the sniper though. A bullet hits Halbert, bringing him down. Another one hits Semblance, badly injuring her knee. While all of this happened, Rock was able to walk up to the grunts holding the feline. He tried convincing them that beating up someone smaller than them is a bad thing, but that didn't work out. They engaged him into a fight. One got cut into four pieces, the other one followed Jeff's order to retreat. He then picks up the girl, not like a firefighter would do it, but in the way you would carry a sack of potatoes. He notices that the sniper is aiming at him and throws her out of his line of sight. As he does that, a bullet pierces his neck. Before leaving the area with his men, Jeff turns around to Katze for one last time, telling her that even though she's hot, he still hates her. She confesses her love to him. He runs away. Semblance goes ahead and gets Halbert up using a health potion. She then gets to the girl and gives her a hug. The sniper didn't attack her while walking, he seems to be gone from the roof. After Halbert recollects himself, he gives Rock a potion. While all of this happens, Katze is looting the dead bodies. She finds a bit of money and a cell phone with Jeff's number on it. Also, Kalkydra finally appears. He missed the fight, but now he is here. Just as he arrives, the door of the building the sniper was placed on opens. A man carrying a rifle and two turrets gets out. Apparently, he has taken the wrong exit. Still carrying all of that stuff, he turns around and runs back inside. While Halbert and Rock try to go after him, Kalkydra rushes past them like an arrow, and despite the sniper wearing exo-equipment on his legs that's supposed to make him faster, he reaches him in seconds and smashes him against the wall where he holds him until the other boys arrive. The sniper is a Libri, his name is Spike, on his shoulder is a little kiwi, his name is Fawn. According to him, he is not a member of the gang, just an assassin slash mercenary who was hired by them. After hearing that, Rock convinces him to work for Eden instead, for the payment of two goats and a cow. They allow him to continue carrying his rifle and turrets, don't restrain him, and they all walk out together. Semblance has given the feline a potion in the meantime. She doesn't want to give out her name, so she gives them her code name, Flamestreak. She is a member of an organization called the Scrappers, which is known for knowing a thing or two. She wants to help the CEOs out with some information as thanks for saving her. Semblance asks about the headquarters of the Trifactor gang. Flamestreak writes down the address on a piece of paper. It can be found inside of the headquarters of Triple Dawn Industries, a clothing company, one of Corinia's biggest corporations. She also gives Rock another piece of paper, which is only meant for him. She then gets on her way. The CEOs talk for a couple of minutes about what they should do now, then they suddenly feel the air grow heavy. A single person walks up to the group. It's a man of huge stature in a blue uniform wearing a mask. He straps the mask off, takes a big sip from the sake he has with him, and greets everyone. His name is Bird. He is an adjudicator, one of the elite warriors employed by the city of Corinia. He lectures the CEOs about how he usually isn't allowed to tolerate vigilante justice, even if it is just. However, apparently there are a few special rules for registered logistics companies, so they are all good. Nevertheless, he tells them to be careful, since most other adjudicators wouldn't have acted like him in this situation. He then sees them off by telling them to stop by the enclosed shell sometime, the bar he frequents every day. It is in dire need of new customers. Once he leaves, a lot of pressure leaves the air around them. A lot has happened this day, so everyone decides to go and have some gyros for lunch. After a while, the CEOs return to the Eden HQ. Their first expedition into the city went alright, they gathered some very basic information and a new ally. Mem is not very surprised by the information they tell him. He already was suspicious of Triple Dawn Industries. He tells them what they should do next. In about a week, the company will hold a great fashion gala, hosted by Sun himself. He suggests to infiltrate the HQ during that event. Until then, he wants everyone to prepare for that operation by gathering as much information as possible. After saying that to everyone, he goes to the back room with Spike in order to negotiate his employment contract for Eden Logistics. Since Semblance took a bullet to the knee during the fight earlier, she will stay at the HQ and rest. Asia and the other CEOs come up with places and people they want to investigate, and then get going. Katze pulls out the phone she looted earlier. She decides to call Jeff with it. He is completely disturbed by the fact that she calls him with his dead comrade's phone and hangs up. But she calls him again. Katze tells him that she believes in him, that he is a good person, and that he will make the right decisions. Without sounding very happy, he sends her a text with coordinates, and Katze gets there as soon as possible. It's a random alleyway somewhere in the city. It appears like he came alone. Katze approaches him very happily. Jeff immediately gets very angry at the fact that she actually came alone and that this isn't a trap. They are enemies. They should fight. He points a gun at her, but Katze continues smiling, saying that he will not shoot her. She comes closer, telling him that he is just confused, and leans in to kiss him on the cheek. As she leans in, he grabs her by her ponytail, flips her around so that she's below him, and gives her the biggest, most aggressive kiss she has ever experienced. Then he drops her to the ground and runs away as fast as possible. She tries to go after him, but doesn't manage to catch up. Instead, she notices a piece of paper which she apparently dropped. It has a 4-digit code on it. 4138. Happy about her accomplishments, Katze returns to the HQ. Kilkaidra goes to the enclosed shell, that one bar which Bird the Adjudicator mentioned to everyone earlier. His goal is to meet him there in order to get some useful information out of him. He gets there and the bar is extremely clean and tidy. The barkeeper would never admit to it, but the place really is not doing well at all. That's why he spends all of his time just cleaning the place. The only customer currently there is Bird, legs on the table, chugging a jug. He notices Kilkaidra and invites him to sit down with him. The Sancta asks a few questions about the upcoming gala, but Bird notices that he doesn't really feel well. They end up talking about different things instead. After a while, Kilkaidra gets rather quiet. Out of nowhere, Bird pulls out a bottle of booze and places it on the center of the table. As a man who's also constantly drunk, he says, "I know that you don't do it because you like the taste." Kilkaidra replies by saying that he thought he was hiding it rather well. He didn't think that it was that obvious. Bird tells him about how he shouldn't be hindering his own abilities with booze, if not for himself, then maybe for his companions. "I always wondered who would win in a fight. Me or Halo? I don't have nearly the same dread for Kilkaidra. Get your life back together. I think you can." He refuses to elaborate and leaves. But not before paying, of course. After thinking about what he just heard, Kilkaidra also pays and leaves for the HQ. Rock has been told that he should go and stake out the actual Triple Dawn HQ. He goes into a supermarket and picks out a bunch of steaks. After having taken enough of them, he confidently walks out. The employees are so impressed by how confident this big crocodile was that they don't even question what just happened. Next he goes to the park and picks up a couple of stones and sticks and a bit of firewood. With all those things, he goes to the Triple Dawn HQ. He enters the building and starts looking for a nice place in the main entrance hall that would be suitable for his plans. He eventually finds it and makes a campfire, over which he starts to cook the steaks. While doing that, he shouts, "Hello! Eden Logistics is holding a steak out! You can eat delicious steaks made by me, owner of Eden Logistics." Most people try to ignore him, they act as if they don't see him and walk a bit faster. However, one man approaches him. It's a Cortus, wearing a camera and the ugliest suit Rock has ever seen. His name is Lewis. He is fascinated by what he is doing. According to him, the stakeout is an act of rebellion against the society capitalism has placed on this world. Rock offers him a steak. The man starts crying and takes a bite out of it. He asks Rock to allow him to make pictures of this whole thing. He of course allows it. For the next 30 minutes or so, Rock is cooking the steaks, while the Cortus jumps around the campfire, making countless of pictures. Rock wants to attract at least a few people to his stakeout, so he goes out of the building and picks up a random piece of cardboard lying around somewhere. With his claws, he writes Eden Logistics Company Stakeout on it and places it over the campfire. By now, a couple of reporters have also taken notice of what he is doing, and a bunch of them take a bunch of pictures of him, including the Eden Logistics shield. As all the steaks are finished, he walks around the main hall trying to distribute them, yet nobody takes one. Rock is a bit sad, but his new friend tries to comfort him. He may not have distributed his steaks, but at least he distributed art. Rock connects the dots. He has distributed art, and his steaks are art? Mission complete, the stakeout was a success. He says goodbye to Lewis, cleans up most of his mess, takes the steaks, and leaves for the Eden HQ. Halbert got told to check on one specific Trifactor Gang warehouse. He finds it. There are two beaten up grunts lying in front of it. The door is bent and broken down. Ignoring them, he enters and finds 12 more grunts, equally beaten up. All this damage has been caused by Asia, who checked out the place earlier. Just like the warehouse in which they found her not that long ago, the back of the building seems to straight up be a laboratory. There is exactly one person who seems to be conscious and awake. A man called Tony, the leader of this warehouse. Halbert interrogates him. He is terribly scared, yet he doesn't really reveal any useful information. Then the Sarkas makes a mistake. He mentions Eden Logistics. Immediately, the warehouse leader jumps away, trying to get to the laboratory parts. Halbert cuts off his legs, but Tony manages to get into a big tube, similar to the one Asia came out of. The Sarkas tries to destroy it from the outside, but its material is way too strong. He then decides to look for potentially useful information inside here himself. He doesn't find anything, except for a pallet of vials, similar to the ones Asia is carrying with her. He decides to take them and leaves for the HQ. But not before covering the entire interior of the warehouse in flammable liquids and setting it ablaze, including everyone inside. He even took in the two who were lying in front of the door. The four CEOs get back to the HQ and realize that without semblance they weren't able to accomplish anything. They quickly change the topic and talk about stakes. Suddenly, the door bursts open. Asia enters, panting, her robotic arm completely destroyed, bruises everywhere, and with a big bag around her shoulder. Mem tells her to get into a room and so to enter. By now it's gotten dark outside and the CEOs begin preparing stakeout too, this time only for Eden employees. Spike also has ordered a few pizzas for everyone in order to make up for shooting them earlier the same day, and Calcaedra mixes a few drinks for everyone. Halbert actually asks Lamette to join everyone. She says that she's not allowed to sit with the CEOs, so he has to order her to join them. After some time, Asia, who now only has one arm, joins everyone as well, way later, even Semblance. Mem never joins the group, he just watches from afar. There's only one other thing that happens this evening. Halbert gives Asia the vials he found inside of the warehouse. The next day comes and everyone gets down to eat breakfast. The food was prepared by Lamette, she herself isn't there though. While they eat, Mem arrives for the morning briefing. He pulls out a vial. Apparently, this is what Asia managed to retrieve yesterday. Mem tells them what he knows about the liquid inside of the vial. It consists of very highly concentrated originium, and it gets used by the Trifactor Gang for some purpose. The only other thing he knows about it is that it gets produced by the Sephir Clinic, a medical facility inside of the slums. He wants the CEOs to go there and investigate it. For that, he gives them Eden Logistics passes, which they need in order to enter and leave the slums. Spike also gives them Fawn as a companion on the way. Asia will stay at the HQ, because without her robotic arm she will not be useful out there. After getting ready, the CEOs get going. The divide between the slums and the rest of Corinia is massive. The area is surrounded by big walls with countless of watchtowers, which are manned by guards. The entrance to the slum area the CEOs approach is blocked by an electrified fence. One of the guards asks everyone for their passes so that he can let them in. Rock, however, just walks into the fence and gets electrocuted. Helbert gives him a shoulder, they show the passes to the guards, and they are allowed to go through the gates. The slums are pretty much completely made up of makeshift houses, there's graffiti everywhere, a few shady people here and there, a bunch of small stands selling food and random items. Semblance actually buys a little teddy bear from one of them. It doesn't take them long until they find the clinic. The line in front of the main entrance is extremely long. Rock wants to attack the door, however, Semblance says that Katze is going to command this operation. The feline decides to enter the clinic through the back door. The yard in front of the door is filled with people. There's around 20 trifactor grunts and two people who appear to be nurses. They are busy with loading the crates onto a truck. One of the nurses is a small guy with really bad posture and a sad face. The other one is a huge cheerful girl with an unzipped jacket which reveals an Alive Until Sunset t-shirt. The CEOs observe everything from afar for a bit and they see how after a while most grunts get into the truck and drive away. The only people remaining are the two nurses and one gang member. He is gonna be their target. They try to capture him, but Helbert accidentally ends his life. While they discuss what's next, they hear the two nurses talking. The girl wants to make a bet with the guy on whether the CEOs will survive what's next. They don't get the opportunity to think about what that means. The man's dead body starts twitching and it starts growing and suddenly explodes into a pile of organs and blood. It's disgusting. Out of the remains of his body, a massive creature emerges with a large mouth, multiple tentacles and eyes planted all over its body. It's a monster called Project Silver. A brutal fight ensues. Semblance gets knocked down. Helbert's sword gets stuck in the monster. Rock manages to free the sword by shooting an arrow directly at the point the blade is stuck. He follows that brilliant move up by biting into the monster and ripping some of its flesh out. While the fight continues, the meat in his mouth starts transforming. First it grows arms and legs, then a blade and a crocodile mouth. Rock now has a mini rock inside of his mouth, which starts to attack him. After a very long fight, Helbert manages to cut the monster's throat open. It slowly starts dying. Before its life ends, though, it tries one last attack. The head detaches from the rest of the body and flies towards him with an open mouth. He uses his sword like a baseball bat and punches it back to the rest of the body. The parasite inside of Rock's mouth dies as well. He gets incredibly sad because of that. To him it was Pebble, his son. He was trying to replicate me because I am the only one who can defeat myself. The fight is over. The CEOs regroup. Helbert gives Semblance a health potion. The two nurses react very differently to the fight's outcome. The short male one doesn't really do anything. The huge female one cheers them on, applauds, puts her arm around Helbert's shoulder and leads the group inside. The two nurses are called Dee and Lorenza. They are two Aegirian siblings. They lead the CEOs inside and they show them the head of the Sephir Clinic, Dr. Amanda Roost. Semblance greets her by saying, "Are you doing this because you want to, or because they are forcing you to?" The chicken doctor, who was immersed in her research, looks up at her and asks what she is talking about, to which she just points at all the monster blood that's still on her. The doctor has to think for a moment. She then shouts, "Has someone injected the prototype? This isn't for consumption." She rushes out, the rest following her. As she gets out and sees the aftermath of what happened there a couple of minutes ago, she stands still for a moment, then just goes to a nearby trash can and starts vomiting. The CEOs try to explain to her that this is the result of her working on a serum for the gang. She thinks that this is all just a big tragic accident. She doesn't think that Sun would ever do something bad. After all, he is the one financing the Sephir Clinic. Without him, they wouldn't be able to keep the lights on here. Also, this is just supposed to be an oripathy treatment serum. It makes invasive originium crystals enter the body and keeps the oripathy organ in check. It's based on prototypes created by her predecessor. She wanted to dispose of them, but Sun approached her and made her an offer she couldn't deny. The CEOs makes a proposition to be the clinic's sponsors instead. She could continue her research from the Eden basement if she wanted to. Amanda isn't opposed to that, however, she can't just betray her official deal with Sun. But she might be ready to do it if they can prove that the gang is using her research to do bad stuff. Since she is needed at the clinic, she can't just leave this place to look at evidence. Katzis suggests kidnapping her, and Amanda calls for Lorenza, yet she doesn't see any danger and leaves again. The party debates on how to tackle the situation. They decide to call the Eden HQ and ask Asia to bring them the vial Mem showed them earlier. The sloth gets on her way. In the meantime, they all get some ice cream from a local ice cream place. While they are ordering, Dee also enters the store. He gets a small portion for himself and a gigantic one for his sister. The CEOs and nurses then all hang out in the yard in front of the back door and enjoy their ice cream after Lorenza had cleaned up all the blood and organs. Dee has a nice conversation with Rock actually. The Arcosauria tells him about how he lost his son in battle today. The Aegirian tells him about how he once read a biology book and learned about what happens to male anglerfishes. He has been like this ever since. After some time, Asia arrives with a new arm. They all go inside in order to show Amanda the vial. She doesn't care about the vial, however, something interesting happens. The doctor recognizes Asia. She calls her Ren and says that she's the daughter of the local baker who passed away and that she was treated by the clinic for oripathy with her serum. Asia does not believe her at all. This is completely different to the memory she has in her head. In order to find out the truth, they decide on the following. Asia's blood will be sampled in order to check whether her and that Ren are one and the same person. And as it turns out, that's indeed the case. Furthermore, she finds out that the treatment serum inside of her is not the exact same as the one at the clinic. It has been modified by the gang without her knowledge. Amanda is convinced now. Convinced that Sun is using the serum for a different purpose than what he told her. She wants to change sides and tells Lorenza to call Sun in order to nullify the contract. Halbert tells her that announcing it to Sun would be a very bad idea, and Semblance says that the solution might actually be to kidnap her. If Sun and the gang believe that the one making the serum was kidnapped, they will not question the fact that they won't be getting any more serum for now, and they will not cancel their cooperation with their clinic. Amanda understands and calls for Dee. She gives him her code and officially announces him as the new head of the clinic. He blushes a little bit. After that, Amanda jumps into a trash bag held by Halbert. In order to make sure that the gang buys the story of her getting kidnapped, the CEOs destroy the clinic's back door in a combined effort. Everyone gets back to the HQ and Halbert tells Amanda to get out of the trash bag. The first thing she sees is Mem, and let's say she was quite frightened by the creature in front of her. Semblance tells her to calm down and explains the role Mem is playing at Eden. The two go to the back room in order to negotiate Amanda's employment contract. The crew hangs out at the bar for a while, sharing a drink or two, but it's already quite late and everyone is rather tired after what happened at the clinic. Nevertheless, Rock leaves the building before going to bed. He collects a few rocks in the nearby park and builds a little memorial for Pebble. Semblance also does something before ending the day. She goes around looking for Lamette, calling out her name. Eventually she finds her, although the prettier girl tried to stay hidden. She hands her the teddy bear she bought earlier as an official gift from the CEOs. Lamette doesn't understand at all. She has never seen something like that before, and she also doesn't feel comfortable about receiving a gift from her higher-ups. But Semblance doesn't elaborate on that. She just tells her to join everyone for breakfast tomorrow and leaves. While walking towards the dorms, she sees Asia, or Ren. She is completely out of it. With what she learned at the clinic earlier, it's pretty much possible that everything she knows about herself is a complete lie. Semblance tries to comfort her by ensuring that she will always be there for her, no matter what happens. The next morning comes. Everyone is eating breakfast again. Lamette again was the one to prepare the breakfast, yet she didn't end up joining them. Amanda is there though, and a bunch of eggs. After some time, Mem eventually walks in for the morning briefing. He explains the next steps to everyone. He has come to the conclusion that they would be horrible at something like infiltrating an HQ. According to him, they should go ahead and approach the situation in a different way, by stealing the identities of two actual models and their respective crews, and to infiltrate the fashion gala as them. He shows the two models he had in mind and suggests that they should make sure they got into accidents. most of the crew does not really like the idea of doing that. The only one to very openly oppose Mem, though, is Rock. The Snake's plan clearly goes against everything he believes in. At that, Mem invites Rock to the back room. Halbert asks the crocodile whether he really wants to be alone with him, but Rock makes it very clear that he is not scared at all. In the back room, Mem tells Rock to hold still for a moment. He pulls out his glitchy hand and points it at him, then slowly turns it to the left. Rock gets atomized. His particles fly through the air while his mind is completely conscious. After a while, Mem turns his hand to the right and his body materializes again. His head is dizzy, all of his muscles ache, and he coughs up blood. Mr. Rock, congratulations, Mem says. You officially have 2 months to live. Rock is not impressed. He is not scared of dying at all as long as he keeps his honor. He still very openly opposes Mem. The Snake tries to explain to him that he is meant to do good and accomplish great things and not meant to die because of something like honor. Rock still is not impressed in the slightest. With blood still dripping out of his mouth, he turns around and starts walking towards the door. It's locked. The two have a staring competition for a couple of seconds. Mem warns him again about how he is gonna get himself and all of his companions killed one day. He then uses his arm to deatomize and reatomize Rock again, this time with a fully functioning body. I am not in the business of wasting assets, Mr. Rock. You are free to go. The Arcosauria calls Mem a coward and says a few other things, but he just gets back to his desk and continues his usual office work. Rock leaves the back room and tells the CEOs about everything that just happened. Kalkyra spits out his beer, Halbert almost wets his pants. Katze immediately goes to confront Mem, yet nothing happens. They get together again, and they all agree that at least for now, they should do what he tells them to do and not go against him. Rock is in a very interesting headspace right now. He is very motivated to take down the gang because of what they are doing, yet he says that he will do it the honorable way, not the way Mem intended to. He tells that to the others. So, the CEOs Spike and Asia go out. They will try to talk to the two models and acquire their identities without any violence. Other than that, they also have 2 other goals. Getting the blueprints of the Triple Dawn HQ from the building's architect and acquiring the rights to use the roof of a nearby building so that they can place their sniper on it. Those were all side missions which Mem wrote on a piece of paper together with the two models' personal informations. They first arrive at the place of the first model, a Zalak, who is called Roxanne Beveur. It's a very luxurious house with a large front yard and multiple security guards. They explain that they want to talk to Beveur, and one of the guards pulls out a tablet. The model appears on the screen, and she tells her guards to show her everyone trying to get in. She proceeds to rate the looks of every single one there. She tells most of them that they are very ugly, especially Halbert and Asia. Interestingly enough, she really, really takes a liking to Spike. She seems very excited and allows them to enter. According to the guards, all the ugly ones have to stay out. By that they mean Asia, Halbert, and Kalkyra. Semblance tells Asia to not be sad, Rock does the same thing with Halbert and Kalkyra. The rest gets in, and they see that the inner guards are substantially better looking than the ones on the outside. Apparently, she has hired her men in order of their looks. They go through a big door into a very ugly decorated living room. 2 of the guards open another door, and Beveur enters. It seems like she rather quickly put on makeup and changed her hairstyle into twin tails. She is absolutely mesmerized by Spike's looks. Because of that, she instantly agrees to giving her identity and invitation papers for the gala to Eden. She has just 1 condition, getting Spike for 2 hours. The CEOs decide that their sniper should take one for the team. Rock tells him that he will compensate him with 4 cows. During the entirety of this, Rock was very serious. Semblance asks Katze about whether she noticed that, but she answers that she is very angry and upset about the fact that Beveur insulted her looks. They get out and see that Kalkyra and Halbert have nearly emptied a bottle of whiskey while the others were negotiating. Rock asks Asia to stay near the mansion until they allow Spike to leave. Everyone else makes their way to the next model. Her name is Lyness Jones. She is an Aslan from Victoria and she lives in a regular apartment. It's still in the more well-off parts of the city and still relatively luxurious, but nothing in comparison to Beveur's place. They ring the bell, the door opens, and the crew sees a lion who is done with life. She tells them to hurry up if they want to kill her. She doesn't have enough time. The crew explains what they actually want from her, and Lyness tells Semblance that she is a complete mess, and that she wants to fix her. She doesn't really like events like the gala and the corporatism going on inside of the city. However, she still loves modeling and everything that comes with it. She wants to fix semblance and turn her into a model so that she will take her place at the event. Katze completely misunderstands the situation. She wants to be a beautiful model on the runway and is very offended that the second model also didn't like her. She sees this as a great setback in her quest for Jeff's love and runs out, with her dagger drawn. Rock goes after her. In the meantime, the Lion Lady has emptied 3 cups of coffee. Being fixed by Lioness means that Semblance would have to stay with her for a couple of days. Halbert isn't really happy about that. He offers to be a guard and to sleep in front of the apartment's door, but Semblance ensures him that it's gonna be alright. By now, another 2 cups of coffee have been emptied. Kalkydra and Halbert leave the apartment in order to look for Rock and Katze. The Arcosauria has managed to catch up with the feline. He stops her and gives her some advice for the Jeff situation. According to him, men want to be hunters and not hunted. She should stop pushing so hard and instead tempt him into hunting her. Katze is convinced, yet when asked for further information, Rock doesn't know how exactly she should do that. He tells her to ask Semblance instead. After all, she bade Halbert chase after her. She rushes back in the direction of Lioness' apartment. Rock doesn't follow her. There are still things that need to be done. Halbert and Kalkydra run into Katze. She asks Halbert who he would rather sleep with, her or Semblance. The Sarkas doesn't quite understand and tells her that he doesn't want to procreate since he is infected. Unhappy about that answer, Katze wants to return to Lioness' apartment, but by now the others have had enough of that stuff, so Halbert picks up Katze by the scruff of the neck like an actual cat, and they start walking towards the next location. Rock has already arrived there by now. He is very intent on proving Mem wrong by accomplishing all the side missions they got in his way. The location is a small house in the slums, the place of residence of an old man, the architect who built the Triple Dawn HQ. Rock explains what he needs from him. The old man takes a sip of tea and asks Rock to spend some time together. He wants to play a game with him, and if Rock wins, he gets what he wants. Rock would love to play with him, but even if he loses, he still needs the blueprints. He is ready to come and visit him every now and then, though, if he wants someone to keep him company. The old man tells him that it's bad to make promises you will have to break. In order to get the blueprints, Rock has to solve the following riddle. When in the architect's life does down become up, and left become right, floor becomes ceiling, and sky becomes earth? Rock doesn't have the correct answer. He tells the old man that he isn't good at riddles, to which he asks why he ended up coming alone then, and not together with his companions. Rock explains that he is trying to prove a point to someone about how you can achieve results through good means as well. The man involves Rock into a deep conversation, a debate if you will, about how he maybe should change the way he walks through this world. I will continue walking my own path, regardless of what you and the others say, because I know that my path is just. He smiles as if he had made his point and leaves the house. By now, the other 3 have arrived. Rock tells them about the riddle and they enter the old architect's house. They don't have an interaction as deep as Rock with him. After a lot of thinking and a couple of failed guesses, Kalkydra is the one who finds the riddle's solution, if he holds the blueprints upside down. The old architect keeps his promise. They acquire the blueprints of the Trifactor headquarters and a weird plaque, which just shows a side profile of the same building. The 3 leave the old architect's house and meet up with Rock. Another objective achieved. Their next stop will be the main building of a company called Nutrition HQ. It's a company that has the monopoly on food production and trade in Corinia's slums. It is only important to Eden, though, because the building is the only skyscraper close to the Triple Dawn HQ. They just need the roof. The 4 enter through the main entrance and get greeted by a secretary. We need your roof, Halbert says. The secretary has no idea what the Tsarkas wants from her, but after elaborating a little bit more, she tells everyone to go and talk to the company CEO. While passing her, Rock pats the secretary on the shoulder and says, "You have done a good thing today." A tear runs down her cheek. While Katze takes the elevator, the boys use the stairs. They get into the CEO's office, ring the doorbell, and he allows them to enter. He is a Caprine who is just known as Mr. Vincent, and he is pretty open to what the Edenlets have to say. He is ready to give them the roof, as long as they pay for it. There is just one problem. The roof has already been rented out by someone, a researcher called Dr. Augustus Quacks. He will have to agree to Eden being there as well. During that dialogue, something has caught Halbert's attention. A paper, lying on Vincent's desk. Since he assumes that at this point everything might be connected to the gang, he asks him about it. He explains that it's a notice of withdrawal. The secretary they talked to earlier is called Maria Blanche, and she has gotten infected while working for the company. Having contracted oripathy, she can't be employed for much longer. Rock is disgusted by this story. He does not understand why Vincent doesn't treat the members of his company as his friends. Angered, he leaves the room. Halbert asks the CEO about Maria's contact details since Eden is still looking for people to hire. He gives them to him. Vincent has also told them that Dr. Quax was at the roof at this very moment and that they are free to talk to him right away. The boys follow Rock, who is taking the stairs to get to the top. Katze takes the elevator again. After quite a while, they arrive on the building's roof. They see a bunch of tents and crates, a few machines, the equipment of the man they want to talk to, Dr. Augustus Quax. He doesn't notice the CEOs at first until Katze approaches him. She explains who they are and what they want. Sadly, Quax says that he is doing some very important research on his roof and that it is impossible for them to be there at the same time. If one of them was a researcher though, that would be a different thing. He elaborates on his research. The mobile city's engine is working normally, the city's velocity itself is as it should be, everything is working at a normal pace, apart from the city as a whole. Outside of the city, it is slower. Everything is working, it is just slower. It's as if the entire city had been slowed down. He suggests some sort of art being the reason for that. But why? Who would want it? He needs this roof to watch the city so that he can find out the reason for that phenomenon. Katze explains how her father was researching a cure for oripathy and that she knows a thing or two as well. Quax gets very excited when he hears that she has some knowledge about the medical field. He walks over to a small fridge he had set up. Apparently, he takes blood samples of himself on a regular basis as a part of his research here. He pulls out two test tubes and shows them to Katze. They are two blood samples which were taken 2 hours apart, but she checks on them and understands what he is trying to show her. The blood in one of them seems like it is multiple days older than the other one. There has to be something to what the doctor is saying. Halbert is very scared. He proposes leaving the city, to which Rock says, "If you run away now as you face your greatest fears, you will regret it one day." Halbert seems like he remembers something. His eyes get kind of red and he averts his gaze from the others. Katze and Dr. Quax speculate about the whole situation for a bit. Among other things, she tells him about how a very important thing will happen in about a week. They come to the conclusion that Eden should place one of their members on the roof together with Quax during that one specific night. And thus, the roof was acquired. While leaving the building, they pass the secretary again. Halbert tells her that if she needs further employment, she should go ahead and contact Eden Logistics. She is very confused, but Halbert refuses to elaborate and leaves. The CEOs get back to the HQ and Rock goes straight to Mem's back room. He is just sitting at his desk, working. Rock walks up to him. In one hand he has the list of goals to accomplish that Mem gave them earlier. In the other hand he has a knife. He puts the list on the table and stabs his knife through it, carving a deep hole into the mahogany wood. Rock proclaims that nobody was killed and nobody was kidnapped and they still got all the results. Mem is very calm. He explains that he doesn't really care about how results are brought in, as long as they are brought in. Rock continues telling Mem that he is weak and afraid for a bit longer, yet eventually leaves. Later that day, Halbert also stands in the door to Mem's back room. He just tells him that another employee will be arriving soon. The table is completely fine. No holes in it. Not a lot happens to most of the CEOs in the next few days. Semblance trains with Lioness day and night, getting addicted to coffee in the process. Kalkhydra practices with his revolver. Katze and Halbert go shopping, and she picks out a really nice hood for him. The same day she chats a bit with Jeff, using the phone she picked up from the corpse of one of his friends. He tells her that he will block her if he sees her or hears from her within the next 7 days. But after that 1 week, he might be open to a fresh start. There's one person who has a rather interesting experience during those days. Rock spends quite some time in the park not far from the HQ, working out and exercising with his bow. Someone approaches him while he is doing that. A huge white-haired Sarkas starts using a punching bag Rock had set up. They talk for a bit and Rock finds out that she is called Skull and she is looking for someone, a Sarkas called Cleave. Apparently, he killed her family and she now wants to take revenge. Rock tells her about the only other Sarkas he has seen in the city. He calls him Great Chief and describes Halbert's appearance in great detail. Skull expresses a great interest in one day meeting that Great Chief. The two actually meet up again the next day in order to spar for a little bit. Rock learns that Skull is incredibly strong. The headbutts she gives him send him flying through the air. He knows that if she wanted to, she could end him right here, right now. But both enjoy the sparring nonetheless. While the two are training, Halbert feels a chill down his spine. Sadly, him and Skull don't get the chance to meet each other because the day of the gala arrived. While Spike is already placed on the Nutrition HQ roof together with Dr. Quax, a few others have joined the regulars at Eden. Lorenza is here, and so is Lioness, together with a lot of coffee. They agree on the following plan. The blueprints reveal that there is a hidden entrance at the back of the building. The plaque seems to be the key to opening it. Rock is gonna take everyone's weapons into a sack and sneak them into the building that way. The rest is gonna enter through the main entrance using the invitations of Beauvoir and Lioness. Everything is ready, there is one problem though. Everyone is wearing their tuxedos and dresses they were given, apart from Rock. He doesn't want to wear it. Lamette, who was the one to prepare all the clothes, is very sad as she hears that. Lorenza gets up and using brute strength, she forces Rock into a tuxedo. Now everyone is ready to get going. Semblance, Asia, Halbert, Katze and Kalkaidra approach the main entrance. There's a red carpet, a bunch of bouncers and photographers, and a big problem. One of the bouncers is Ox, the man who attacked the Eden HQ a week ago. But they are very lucky, because a countless man with a camera jumps out from the line of photographers and paparazzi, catching Ox's attention, and since he is forced to deal with the man's behavior, he does not recognize any of the Eden members while they get in. The inside is very fancy, a bunch of high-class people, nobles, officials, and models of course, a lot of waiters running around, and someone sticks out from the crowd. A blonde Vulpo man, wearing a very nice suit. As if he was sensing someone's presence, he turns his head towards the group. He completely ignores everyone, apart from Kalkaidra. After a couple of seconds, he excuses himself from the people he was talking to and leaves. The others have noticed the stare down between the two and ask him whether this is their target and about what the soul staring thing was about. Kalkaidra tries to avoid answering them. The crew splits up. Halbert and Asia stay with Semblance. After a bit, Asia splits away from them as well, saying that she's gonna scout a bit on her own. Katze is walking by herself. She is strolling through the main hall, trying to present herself and to be as eye-catching as possible. She actually manages to catch the attention of two people, Jeff and Hecate. They stop her, and the latter one points her lightning rod at her back. Meanwhile on the outside, Rock is approaching the backside of the building. He reaches the point he was told to check on and finds a weird hole in the wall. It's like a big keyhole. He puts the plaque into it and a terminal opens. There he enters the 4-digit code Katze found on Jeff and a hidden door opens. He enters and finds a room very similar to the Trifactor labs he had already seen, but it seems way more advanced. The machines seem like they are from the future and there's a blue hue covering everything. In the midst of all of that, he makes a very interesting discovery. What a cliffhanger! Thanks for watching! This was around 20 hours of content condensed into one. The rest of Arc 1 is gonna be put into a separate video because KineMaster can't export projects larger than 1 GB, but it should come out very soon. And if you don't want to wait, every session is up on the Harmacist channel, which you should go and subscribe to anyway. The point where I ended today's summary is a very good point to actually start watching the sessions. So, the next summary will deal with sessions 7 and 8, the finale of the current arc, and after that there's gonna be another summary dealing with session 9, the Halloween special. While I start working on them, let me thank my wonderful channel supporters and operators, and my absolutely astounding channel commanders. Ankoku, Azriel, Big Bob, Chris, Erwin Heckler, Eisel, Heiligkeit, Longo, LWKY, Vritten, Yelena, and Zephyrenix. Thanks a lot for your support, guys, and to you, thanks for watching. Check out the Harmacists, and I hope I will see you next time, and in the streams. Cheers!